also doing that while he was there, he's trying to get the water survey or the water well for the discounted water.
That is a good thing now. He's also doing that while he was there, he's trying to get the water survey.
Anything else?
Chelsea goes back to the mineralogist on Tuesday.
That is a good thing now. He's also doing that while he was there, he's trying to get the water survey.
Anything else?
Chelsea goes back to the mineralogist.
That is a good thing now. He's also doing that while he was there, he's trying to get the water survey.
Okay, that's pretty good. Father, we just bow our heads in worship and adoration. So often in life, we don't know what to ask for. We don't know what to do or what to say, but God, we know you're here and here and you love us. Lord, we just thank you so often in life. We thank you for being patient. We don't know what to do. Gracious with us to guide us, Lord Jesus, to bring us your life, to give us hope, Lord, and save us from being dead. Lord, I just pray that you grace us to lift up all these men and women.
Thank you.
Could you bow your head with me? Father God, as we enter into a time of teaching and preaching of your word, we pray for your guidance and your direction. Lord, help us to see and understand, to understand what your word is telling us and guiding us in. Lord, I pray for hope to be in this house today, and Lord, help us. Your love, Lord Jesus, to be upon us, that we would know it, and that would show us that we are guiding us in. Thank you, and we pray for our hope to pay for us in this Sunday that we celebrate your resurrection. Your almighty name, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. So the question I have been pondering today and over this sermon to start off is this. What is the best thing someone has ever done
today and over this sermon?
The best thing that someone has ever done for you. I just want you to think about it in your own mind. You know, it's asking you that question, I really want you to think deep on this, because as I've been thinking over that, I've really been trying to ponder my head. I've had people give me gifts, I've had people help me with full times, I've had people drive me places, I've had people drop what they were doing in their lives for my sake. But in my own head, the thing I think about is my mom tucking me in the bed every night. I ask you that question is because this day is the day that we celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the grave. And I can guarantee there is no one in our life that has even come close to doing what he did for us on that cross. You see, he didn't deserve it. I did. And I knew. But he's the one that laid down his life for me. As we celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ, I know it's a walk through. You know, we come into church on Easter Sunday and we talk about the resurrection, we talk about what Jesus did. But I want to share today from the perspective of Rahab, as you can see here on the screen. We've been going through a study here in our church family on this idea that I love Jesus more. And basically the whole phrase, I love Jesus more, just simply means that whatever I'm facing in life, no matter how difficult, no matter the circumstances, I love Jesus more. It's going to seem true. The scripture literally teaches that he is the great I am, the Alpha and Omega, the one who is and was and is to come. He is the one that can sustain us through everything. And so we've been going through this study of Hebrews chapter 11, which is oftentimes referred to as a hero of faith. And Rahab is the one that's listed today. And notice the description of Rahab here on the screen. It says, by faith, the prostitute Rahab. Now, how many of you normally have a title like that before your name? If it's not really a title, I think anybody wishes to have before their name, but she is described in a picture in the scriptures as a prostitute. And I think that's very, very important that every one of us in this room understand, because I know I've sat in pews before, I've sat in churches before, and I felt like I was out of place, or I felt like I shouldn't be there, or I felt like my sin excluded me from what the preacher was talking about. And my friends, I'm here to tell you God loved every single one of us in this room so desperately that he was willing to allow his son Jesus Christ to die in his place. That is absolutely phenomenal to me. And so today we're going to look at the life of this prostitute, Rahab. God saw so much for him. It wasn't, goes on to say, because she welcomed the spies, was not filled with those who were disobedient. So I'll give you a real quick picture, and then we're going to read some of that story to Joshua. But Rahab lived in a city called Jericho, and Jericho was one of the cities that was in the promised land. That's the people of the Hebrews, the Israelites that came out of Egypt. That was the promised land they were going into, and Jericho was one of the enemy cities. And so the spies had gone into that city to scout it out, and Rahab had an interaction with them. We're going to read about there in these upcoming verses. What we're going to look at as we go through that is, first of all, what are you looking for? And I know when I ask a question like that, what are you looking for? A lot of us would probably answer that pretty simple. I'm looking for bread. I'm looking for some cold. I'm looking for answers. I'm looking for reason or purpose in my own life. These are the kind of things that we're looking for. Rahab was looking for salvation. She was looking for things. And as we ask that question, I want you to think about this. Last week, I was reading this statistic survey that was talking about since 2010 to 2015, the teen suicide rate had increased by 23%. Absolutely, ridiculous. But the thing that the article is talking about, does anybody know anything in 2010 to 2015 that has drastically changed in our culture? It was around 2010 that cell phones were so heavily introduced, and so many people started having those things in their hands. And what the article went on to describe was how so many are caught up in this false sense of what life is in Facebook and Twitter and all this kind of stuff, that we get caught up in these things and we lose sight of the bigger picture of it. And while we talk about technology and Facebook and all the things that men draw us closer, and so often, so often they segregate us from what true life really is. The second thing we're going to look at is that the Lord goes before us. And the thought process of that is, if God is not fighting for you, then you're fighting with vain.
Second thing we're going to look at,
you might as well be fighting with him.
The Lord goes before us
and
goes
with God.
And the thought process of that is,
next one says, and hope and a sign.
Then you're fighting with vain.
A lot of what Scripture talks about, especially in the New Testament, is that God gave his hope. But he gave us a sign of Jesus Christ in his life. And he expects that same thing back in return. We'll take a look at that one right now. And then the last part is God's promises are fulfilled. And that's one of those ones that has repeated through. Every single one of us in this room has experienced somebody breaking their promises. Right? I say that as a given thing. I think it's pretty well true for every single person in the room. God never breaks his promises. In the scriptures, in Joshua chapter 2, verses 1 through 7, it begins the story. It says, then Joshua, son of Nun, secretly sent 2 spies from Shechem. Go look over the land, he said, especially Jericho. So they went and entered the house of a prostitute named Rahab and stayed there. The king of Jericho was told, look, some of the Israelites have come here tonight to spy out the land. So the king of Jericho sent this message to Rahab. Bring out the men who came to you and entered your house, because they have come to spy out the whole land. But the woman had taken the men and hidden them. She said, yes, the men came to me, but I did not know where they had come from. At dusk, when it was time to close the city gate, the men left. I don't know which way they went. Go after them quickly. You may catch up with them. But she had taken them up to the room and hidden them under the stalk of flax she had laid out on the roof. So the men sent out in pursuit of the spies on the road that leads to the fords of the Jordan. And as soon as the pursuers had gone out, the gate was shut. And so just a quick introduction into what we're talking about. Again, Rahab was this prostitute. The 2 spies had turned to her to hide. Their lives were on the line. Literally, they were going to be killed because they were spying out his land, and Rahab had hidden. We don't get much yet of why. We're getting ready to get there in the story in just a moment. But I want you to think about it in your own mind. How many of you have ever been in a desperate situation? How many of you are desperate right now in your own lives? I want you to think about what is it that you're really looking for? I know instantly a lot of us would probably say it's money. That would solve everything. Those kind of things. But when we look at it deeper, when we peel the onion, that's not really what it's all about. What we're really looking for is those relationships. We're looking for God's hand upon it. We want that anointing. And we read time and again, especially in the Old Testament, all the way into the New Testament, of all these men and women of God that are fighting against the wind, when they were trying to ignore God, but God would not ignore them. We have to learn to open our eyes and see who He really is. That's one of my prayers this morning. We are talk about that. The Lord goes before us. It said before the spies laid down for the night, Rahab went up on the roof and said to them, I know that the Lord has given this land to you and that a great fear of you has fallen on us, so that all who live in this country are melting in fear because of you. What was the situation? The whole city of Jericho knew of Israel. The whole city was in fear and they had lost their fellowship. God had gone before them. He goes on to say, we have heard how the Lord dried up the water of the Red Sea for you when you came out of Egypt. And when they did at Shion, God, the two kings of Amorite, in order, he was completely destroyed. When we heard of it, our hearts melted and everyone's courage failed because for the Lord your God is God in heaven above and on the earth below. There's nothing beyond God. Do you understand that this morning? No matter what you're reading, no matter what you look at, God knows the season. It goes on, and now please swear to me by the Lord that you will show kindness to my family because I have shown kindness to you. As we read out this story,
it goes on, now
here's this prostitute. She's taken into these two strangers into her house. These two Israelite men that have been sent to spy out the land. She took them in, she hid them, literally, with fear of her own life. If she had been caught with those two men, guess what would have happened to Rahab? She would have been killed for what she had done,
literally.
But she was looking for something bigger. Notice what it says, the Lord goes before her. My friend, I know every single one of you in this house. I know every single one of you in this house wants good relationships. I know every single one of you wants purpose. Every single one of you wants to feel something. Every single one of you wants to feel everything good. But so often we turn to counter, we turn to all the other stuff instead of turning to the divine. I know, I've been there myself. I know. God tells us, if he does not go before a people, that people go in vain.
I know
that if God is not leading, then whatever we're trying for is not going to succeed. My friends, that's what our forefathers, that's what our parents, our grandparents, and all those understood. And it's something that we desperately need to grasp once again in our own culture. It goes on in Joshua chapter 2, verse 12. Here the two spies are making this oath between Rahab and man. It says, now then, please swear to me by the Lord that you will show kindness to my family because I've shown kindness to you. Give me a sure sign that you will spare the lives of my father and mother, my brothers and sisters, and all who belong to them, and that you will save us from death. And then the two spies reply, verse 14, our lives or your lives, the men assured her. If you don't clean out what we are doing, we will treat you kindly and faithfully when the Lord gives us the land. So let them down by so she let them down by a rope through the window where the house she lived in was part of the city wall. Here's a little picture. And we talked about last week that those people in Israel marched around the city of Jericho for 7 days. They marched around one time each day, and on the last day, they marched around 7 days. And what happened at the end of that? After marching around 7 days, they let out a great shout of praise from the trumpet and the walls crumbled. What kind of walls are we talking about here? If there are literally living quarters built into the wall, we're talking about a massive wall. How did that happen?
If there are literally
last point, living quarters, God was before them. God was fighting the battle for the wall. It goes on to the next verse saying, now, she has said to them, go to the hills so that the pursuers will not find you. Hide yourself there 3 days until they return, and then go on your way. The men said to her, she has said, oath you made, I swear will not be binding on us, unless when we enter the land, you have tied this scarlet cord in the window through which you let us down, and unless you have brought your father and your mother and your brothers and all your family into your house. If anyone goes outside your house into the streets, his blood will be on his own head. We will not be responsible. As for anyone who is in the house with you, his blood will be on our head if I hand his leg on him. But if you tell what you are doing, what we are doing, we will be released from the oath you made us swear. His blood will breach your body. Let it be as you say. So she sent them away, and they departed, and she tied the scarlet cord in the window. window to identify her house. And who would it say?
She had to be quiet, and then she had her time.
Anybody that was in the household, her father, her mother, her brother. And so literally, when we read in the scripture, when we read in the story, who all was saved? Her entire family was saved just because of one person. Her brother called Brandon.
So literally, when we read in the scripture,
you know, I know there are many of you in this room that are here every single week. There are many of you that are praying and crying out for your own sons and daughters. I want you to understand something.
You know, I know
the hope of Jesus Christ.
Yeah, I mean,
that we can
face
your
thinking.
So don't give up. Well, one woman saved her entire family because she was faithful to what was taking place. It goes on to the next part to talk about God's promises are fulfilled. And we jump into chapter 6 of Joshua. This is directly after the walls have crumbled, and this is where they go into Sabor. And it says in these verses, Joshua said to the two men who had spied out the land, go into the prostitute's house, bring her out and all who belong to her in accordance with your oath to her. So the young men who had done the spying went in and brought out Rahab, her father and her mother and brothers, and all who belonged to her. They brought out her entire family and put them in a place outside the camp of Israel. Then they burnt the whole city and everything. But they put the silver and the gold and the articles of bronze and iron into the treasury of the Lord's house. But Joshua spared the prostitute with her family and all who belonged to her because she did the men Joshua had sent as spies to Jericho. And she lived among the Israelites.
God,
140,000 men. God on my side? Anybody else need God on your side? Anybody else feel like you're on the losing side? Get on the right side. Join God. Let him go before
us.
The oath and the sign. The oath that I want to talk to you about today is this oath. Scripture literally teaches in this idea of
the oath and the sign.
All men.
The oath that I want to talk to you about today is
in the name of Jesus Christ.
Scripture literally teaches
the gospel, the truth of who Jesus Christ is. Matter on that day. So I encourage you in faith as we step up. I'm going to have you stand. I'm going to have a single song decision. When we sing that song, I want you to step out in faith. I want you to surrender your life. I want you to walk into it again. You should know what it is. My friends, if Ray happens to be saved, guess what? You can be saved this morning as well. Would you bow your heads as we pray? Father God, if Ray happens to be saved, you tell us. Lord Jesus, intervene for us. And Holy Spirit, work in us right now and change our minds, our hearts, to let us see and know that you are the Lord God Almighty, the one who has created the heavens and earth, the one who gave me life and breath, the one that is in charge and control of all things. Lord, let me know, let us know that you are the one that gives hope. You are the way, the truth, and the life. Lord Jesus, I pray that you would make that clear in this place. I pray for revival to break out in us, and among us, and through us. Lord, I pray for your hand to really minister. God, change our circumstances, our situation, but change us first in our hearts.
Lord, I pray for your hand.
Lord, we know that you poured out your blood for us. We thank you for that. We praise you. Help us to surrender here now today to accept you, Jesus Christ, as our Lord and Savior. It's in your name, Jesus, we pray. So, I'm going to ask you to stand. As we're singing our decision song this morning, I want you to think about this question on the screen here this morning. Who is Jesus in you? What would you personally do with him? I want you to ask yourself that question. It's not something I ask you to say out loud, but just in your heart here this morning, if you think, who is Jesus to me?
What would you personally
do with him? Who is Jesus to me?
I want you to ask yourself that question. It's not something I ask you to say out loud, but just in your heart here this morning, if you think, who is Jesus?
Thank you.
here. And you can have some refills or cakes and chill right now. Turn them outside here in a minute. Also, we have another cake sale with the stuff. We have some of the devil spots. And currently there are two very, very, very nice cakes out of those little five cups. Muslim, and surrender his life to Jesus Christ. quick reminder to that, he was saying about the finances with it. I know I'm not a big sales guy, but we've got almost $200 raised towards $15,000, so we're almost there. Quick reminder to raise 14,800 to go.
I'm not a big sales guy, but we've got almost.
All right. He wants Ron Robinson. Go take Bobby Galante over there and meet Goliath. So I want to bring a bigger guy. Let's pray. Father God, we give you praise, glory, and honor. We thank you for this Sunday morning and celebrate your resurrection. We do that every single day because if you had not, our lives would not have hope.